everyone who just tuned in, welcome, of course, to this stream. It is going to be, again, a tournament match from the Age of Empires Seasonal Championships, and now we are currently at the Summer Championship. I've just covered a round of 128 match before, and now we're going to go into a round of 64 match. It's going to be between Kohensky and Haza, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. And it's going to be on Manchuria, the first map, and the second map was... Wow, my memory, really. Oh yeah, it was on Indonesia, and I think the third one was Cascada Range. So then you know what might be up ahead. And for now, BO3, by the way, round of 64 is still BO3. We are going to have Haza playing India, and Kohensky is going to go for Chinese. This map does have C. I don't expect any of these players to go for C anytime soon, to be honest. More important, early on we have the cows, and let me give you a quick glimpse before they are really taken. You see that there's a cow over here, two cows, here are two cows, and here are two cows. This is always how this map starts out, so just like I mentioned before, know the map, know what you're playing and know what you're up against. And in this case, that's why you should oftentimes be going... Oh, there's also another thing that I wanted to mention, by the way. Oftentimes in this area, if you can see my screen here, this is especially for Wicked, by the way, with my nice, beautiful 1080p screen. Anyway, here there is always or almost always a treasure, and the other one is almost always in this location, actually, like this from here somewhere. So what usually is the best track to go is from your town center towards here, up north grabbing the cows and going up south again. If you have two scouts, then the other one should probably go somewhere like this in the middle, because there's oftentimes one scout over here, and then you can quickly go to your opponent, and because sometimes this treasure is also a little bit on the edge here, so you can try to go for that one as well. Similarly, if you are French and you have a native scout, grab one with your hero and go for your scout to find the other one so that you can maybe steal it from your opponent. Similar, of course, for the Kohensky in this case, you go up there, you get through two cows, which I believe he did. You get a treasure, and then you might also find like this cow or something on the way back. It looks like both of them actually did a pretty good job. It's very obvious that the Indian... Oh, actually, now they say it. I believe that in the end, the disciple from the Chinese players often times just close to his hero in the start for some reason. But I guess just good scouting, because he has the Indian player has 2, 4, 6 cows, and the Chinese guy has 2, 4 cows just. So that is going good. There's... Okay, he has 5 cows. Where is them? 2, 4, 2, 6, 5. There should be oh, there. Okay, let's see if we can get that one home. Meanwhile, funny thing is that none of them picked up any wood treasure yet. I'm quite surprised about that, because obviously if it's so close to your base, you have almost always the time to pick it up. Especially because both of these guys, this one is a kung fu expert with his student, and the other one is 2 elephants, so usually they can take these treasures quite fast. And that means you also don't have to worry too much about your opponent, who might come in to just steal it from you. Looks like he is perhaps going back, and he is gonna find this treasure. Will he be able to steal it? Let me bring you a close-up here. Oh, what is he doing? That was actually a bit of a mistake. I mean, why go away so far? So Kohensky gets it in the end, and he's now also going to chase the elephant for a little bit. Okay. Yeah, so basically China versus India. What can you expect here? China is almost for sure going to age up to the third age, probably some FF, well, actually for sure an FF kind of thing. He's not going to win a long-term H2 fight versus India anyway. And as a response, probably as a blind response, I think the Indian guy is just going for a semi-FF, because that's just probably what is... Well, actually, there are two ways. You can also, of course, separate rush the Chinese player, maybe even with the new kind of strategy with the consulate thing that we've seen a couple of times ago. But I mean, usually in the end, the probably safer thing is to go for some semi-FF with a defensive aggro fort, as you see over here. Otherwise, it would have been a forward aggro fort like over here, and then separate rushing the Chinese player with both of your elephants to use as tanks, basically, to absorb some damage. But as this market early very far back Agrafort, just to defend the base, already working on bringing in some Huns. The dangerous thing for India though is that China is, I mean India is of course quite a strong civilization, but you really can't underestimate China. China in the Third Age is actually pretty strong as well, and as it has been recently kind of rediscovered, it is probably a little bit stronger than most people thought it would be. Especially with the Tower Age up, as we have seen come into play again. And that means that India is not really able to push out early in the Third Age, because they are kind of catching up with the shipments, because the shipments from China are so good. And the economy is quite okay in the back as well, especially of course cows give XP for India, but cows for China are just like 400 food actually. Oh, hold on a second. Sorry, that just quickly crossed my mind, so I had to respond to that. Anyway, this still nice food boost, that was after all my argument. Meanwhile, 7 coin, very standard of course, and the Indian guy is a little bit ahead with the upgrades. That's also very standard, because the Indian guy will just be a little bit slower in the age up to the Third Age. So you might as well work on some upgrades already to get his economy rolling. Basically, China will age up faster and benefit from the, in a way, stronger, let's say, faster shipments. But then again, India has stronger units mid-game, like in the third, later on in the third, and benefits from the or needs the early market upgrades to really compete with, be able to compete with China. He's trying to get something done with 2 separates, but he won't even kill a villager if Kerensky responds on time. He's bringing in the herds quite nicely. I really hope this village is also going to work on this herd, just to be sure that he has everything close to his base. That as soon as the China pushes, that he still is able to gather. We already have the wonder going up. It's 1/3 already. So that will be a very good age up time for the Chinese. Oh, actually the villager did die. Yeah, so that looks like a little bit of a slow response by Kerensky, because usually 2 separates is not able to kill a villager. But anyway, that happens. Oh, and my scoreboard somehow disappeared. There we go. So the Indian guy actually goes for 300 export. Yes, after 600 wood. What we often see lately is 300 export before 600 wood, because you basically don't want to make that many units anyway. So if you have your lot of villagers on wood, you will be able to do your villager production constantly and your upgrades, and the 300 export will give you fast the 4 villages from the consulate. 3 or 4, what is it again? I think 4. I'll check later. Anyway, where is the icon? Anyway, add the villagers from the consulate, which means that it boosts your economy by a little bit more, and then you can send 600 wood afterwards, and then sometimes we see 600 coin, or just trying to age up. But versus China, actually, it might be a little bit too slow without 600 coin. Have to see what he's gonna do here, what he's gonna decide to try to pull off. We have China aging with a tower, 4 villagers, basically is, or 3 or 4, I think close to 4. With 4 wood per second, that's really huge. It's really a big advantage for China to have this tower, because it gives you basically all the wood you need for your houses to really sustain your production, and really don't worry about your population limits. India is gonna age up without 600 coin, looks like, saving a shipment for the Third Age, although one shipment is on the way. If it's 600 coin, I really hope he's gonna cancel it, because obviously he is already at the resource, so he doesn't really need 600 coin anymore. We'll have to see what he is gonna plan to do. Meanwhile, China. Let me have a look. This is all pretty standard. Of course, he's gonna have the Rex in with the 700 wood, he's gonna have the consulate up, and he's gonna have another house. Regarding market upgrades, yeah, the Indian guy has everything, even Imperial Bureaucracy at 7 minutes. That's quite good, of course, because of the 600 wood early. And the Chinese guy is now catching up with that. allied to the British guy, so soon we will also see some musketeers. And he's making cavalry for now. I'm curious to see what he will ship. Looks like the Indian guy, after all, did not cancel his shipment. He sent a wood trickle. That's questionable. In a way, I think, yeah, of course, a wood trickle is like... this is again... 3 villages or something per second, or 2 villages per second or so. Not per second, like overall. But on the other hand, he could have also saved the shipment for the Third Age. I have to think about this. Actually, I'm not sure at the moment what would be best. Maybe there is a way to justify this because your economy will really like explode from there, I guess. 5 more villagers, double the trickle. Yeah, and he of course still has the cows to get his XP rolling. However, China is preparing for a big push here. And he's also eating his cows to make this push even stronger. Although I'm really curious to see what he's planning. He shipped 10 arquebusiers and he has made cavalry. But is he somehow like... No, he's making units. But why is he 1k food? I mean, is he thinking about shipping 1k coin and going to the industrial? Because of how slow India is playing? Perhaps. We have to keep an eye on his resources. He still has a decent army to hold off any pressure from the Indian guy. If he chooses to push. So, and of course he soon has musketeers available as well. Plus he can always ship the intervention card if needed. During his age up to the 4th age. Although intervention, yeah, well, it's always quite good if your Gurkhas are close. I don't know, we have to see. I don't know why he's floating so... Sorry, floating so many resources. What? No, he just invested it in something. His resources drop quite a bit. I was about to say, actually, it might in a way make sense because of how India is playing. He went for a very market-heavy setup. Even, of course, Kowenski can't really know about this, but he even shipped the second trickle. So his army is not like the best. And if the Chinese guy would just defend with this, perhaps he would get away with it. Because of how slow, of course, reinforcements will be as well. If you have to walk all the way from there towards this town center, it's going to be, of course, take quite some time. Anyway, he chooses to just make more units for now and trying to play it out in the Third Age. No training post, by the way, for either player, so Chinese shipments will just come in, let's say, normal rate. But the fact that he was posturing here with the skirmishers might also give the idea to the Indian player that he's really trying to push and just make himself ready for a push, which could then in turn mean that you might just age up just to kind of fool your opponent. Not sure if that was a little bit of a lag moment or what happened there, but this Mahout is really going to get stuck in a place and he really doesn't want to be there doing damage like this. However, he has to fight nonetheless and he's going to be taken down quite fast. Gurkhas were not really effective in the back, unfortunately. The fort is still doing damage. But you see here that the Gurkhas on the left side, while the Zamoreks on the right side. Well, usually you want to have them behind each other so that they can really fight as one and that the cavalry can be sniped off as best as possible. However, he retreats to behind the fort and he is now for sure in a very hard position. He really needs to ship like a 9 Zamorek or something to hold this. I assume that he has more cavalry on the way, the Chinese guy it is, but it's only a few. If I was him, I would probably be making more cavalry, because you don't really need more skirmishers. He is making the skirmisher cavalry batch, but I really dislike this. I think you really should be making just full cavalry batches at this point. Basically, what can you do? Perhaps Mahouts, which means your cavalry are good to block and tank. Or he's gonna do more skirmishers, for which you need cavalry, because you already have enough musketeers and skirmishers to deal with any Zamoreks. So, he's shipping the meteor hammers, that's good. And he's now making full cav batches, so as expected, which is also a good choice there. What is he really making? He shipped 9 Zamoreks. He has quite a good number of Zamoreks here. I'm not sure if he really caught Madman already. He's trying to do as best as possible, my career. But we see that there are constantly disciples beaming it as well from the hero. Actually, the hero is, I don't know where he is. But anyway, we have some disciples in here. And they, of course, are gonna absorb some additional damage here from the Indian player. he's getting pushed further back, although he's microing quite nicely on the cavalry. But is it really enough? Because there's just so much mass from the Indian Chinese player here, and it just keeps coming, as you see over here, more cavalry. Keep in mind that all this time there's of course at least 10 villages in here being idled as well. And there's no such thing as Mahouts on the way. Of course, he just shipped his 9 Zamorak and probably doesn't even have the food to do anything like it, yes. So he's trying to stabilize from here, but it's gonna be really, really tough. Eight Zamboreks, oh that's interesting. Didn't expect it to him to have that in his deck, but he should really micro them a little bit, because these cavalry though have area damage, and they of course have a pretty decent hand attack as well, so you really don't want to be fighting them in hand attack if you can prevent that. So, he looks to stabilize for now at least, but if you see in the scores that the village count is almost even, however of course the trickles do still work for him, but China does have, I think, a better standing army if he mixed in that in as well. The pikemen are really not the most useful shipment at this point, I have to say. I would probably prefer to ship four flail armors or so. But if you use them, you can still put them in cover mode and absorb a lot of damage. He might ship them because he's expecting Mahouts, but knowing how much he pressured, and also he should realize that there were two times Zamborak shipped. That would mean that Mahouts are nowhere close to be shipped yet. And now again we see, by the way, that he has not many skirmishes left, so he probably needs some skirmishes to deal with the Zamborak. So it might be a good idea for him to change back into skirmisher pikemen as he's doing, or skirmisher cavalry. Because there are still Mahouts coming, skirmisher pikemen might be the preferred choice here. He has already a decent number of cavalry. And of course that's the advantage of the Chinese civilization in general. You can really make well-rounded batches. Disadvantage of course being that you only can make these well-rounded batches, meaning that if you lose one unit, or you lack one unit rather, you can't really reinforce them as fast as you otherwise would be able to. But still a very well-rounded army nonetheless. Hard to micro versus, as always. He's shipping the hand mortar. I'm not really sure why. I mean, it's not like you expect two Falcons. There are the Mahouts, by the way. Two Mahouts for, I believe, 500 foot or something is quite a good card. Then there's also three Mahouts, but I believe that's like 800 or 1,000 or something foot, so that's questionable if it's still worth it. But two Mahouts is of course very nice. Can also be a nice shipment surprise. If you, for example, fight close to a town center, always keep in mind that the Indian guy, if you have no idea what he just sent, for example, here we saw the 9 Zamorak. If you have no idea about that, always keep in mind that he might pop two Zamorak just onto your army at any time. Oh, there's of course still a Yuruma shipment as well, by the way, which you should not forget. But so far it looks like he's also gathering up for a Yuruma shipment after. So far there is already a quite nice skirmish account again for the Chinese player. And there's just so many pikemen here that the Indian guy really has to go back. I would really, really let, hopefully, he shouldn't be engaging this. He should really be waiting for like the Yuruma shipment, because they will deal so effectively with all these pikemen. And this is kind of what I was talking about. The well-rounded 3-unit composition army here means that everything goes close, cavalry as well as pikemen. And then kind of, yeah, both Gurkha and Mahouts have to run, which leaves just, yeah, nothing left here in this army, unfortunately. He's trying to micro as best as he can, but in the end it's just too much, and that means that Kohensky is gonna take it. And yeah, there was indeed some lag. Yeah, this seems so. We are both from the EU, and Kohensky is from somewhere like West Africa, not Africa, West USA. So basically, I'm still not sure if it was the best decision to ship this trickle. If you take a look at the post game here, Kohensky did gather more, but Yeah, I think that's mainly due to the cow advantage that he had. At some point, he was eating like 5 cows, which of course fully fed and give you like a 2k advantage in resources. I feel that the Indian guy was actually coming quite close, and I think actually that I would have probably in this situation, because it's China, and I would have probably preferred to ship a third aid shipment rather than the wood trickle during your age up, because you can then for sure better stabilize and fight for the map, which both of these players really need. And then still go into economy perhaps later. Like, I feel that that would have been a little better, but I'm not like paying that much in there, so hard to say. Anyway, Kohensky takes it up 1-0. It's a BO3, round of 64. Second map is going to be Indonesia. Oh, I haven't played that in some time. Yeah, it looks like Haza is a little bit bipolar. He probably means yellow-green or maybe even yellow-red towards Kohensky. I see Kohensky as green, meaning that connection is fine between us, but I even see him as well. I even see him as yellow green now. That's obviously something wrong on his side then. Of course, in Europe it should be just green. Anyone who is in Europe not green to each other is doesn't have the best ping. But I still see Kohensky as full green, even though he's all the way on the other side of the world, basically. What are you doing, Blackstar? Are you sleeping? So, 1-0 for Kohensky. Round of 64, one of the first games, actually the first game, I think, from the round of 64. BO3, so if he wins, he's gonna go to the next round, which is of course, as no one would have guessed, round of 32, and then unfortunately Haza will be out of this tournament. But don't worry guys, there will be more tournaments in the future. And now that I'm mentioning that, keep an eye of course on ESO-community.net, where there's also already an announcement about the donations for the Winter Championship, so you can help to support that so that we can have more tournaments in the future. Yeah, his ping is not really the best at the moment, but yeah, he's not even yellow, so yeah, that doesn't really help. Yeah, your roomie might have been better last game because they are just like in more numbers, and of course there's also the pikemen which do good versus Mahouts, but the pikemen don't really do good versus Yurumi. But then again, Mahouts do a little bit better versus the cavalry than Yurumi do, but I guess in the end if the Yurumi just block the cavalry and deal with the pikemen, then the Zambarax can deal with the cavalry in front, which means that in total the combination with Yurumi is probably a better choice in this case.
Believe it, little boy!
We're just waiting for the moment to hopefully see Haza get his ping fixed, so we can go into a second smooth game. So we're gonna jump into the second game. Hopefully it's gonna be okay. Aztec versus something unknown for the moment. Aztec versus Russia. Okay. Well, on this map, I feel that it's gonna be Aztec favorite. I think that Kowenski is gonna look for some kind of sea play here, as Aztecs. I mean, why not? They are such a good civilization on sea after all. Even on land, they probably have the edge versus German. Versus Russian. Oh wait, this map really? Okay, I'm out, guys. No. For this, for once, I will cast it. Of course, it's a tournament game, game after all. Yeah, this is really like. What can I say about it? Unfortunate to be in a round of 64. Anyway, maybe we're gonna see something interesting. After all, it's like a Borneo, but then a little bit smaller in a way. And what actually have I played this map before? Oh, oops. There's actually a mixture of Indonesia and Borneo, it looks like. So actually there are decent herds on land, but there's no trading post line, so you just won't be able to keep up with the economy from someone who is going to boom on water. So all that's left, if you can't or don't want to boom on water, can't, for example, if the other ship is just better on water, is to kind of... Well, actually, you're probably just doomed. But anyway, you could rush, I guess. Let me see. The other guy has like two herds available, but in this case, Aztec can just make a war herd here and probably be totally fine. I haven't seen this map a lot, so I think that I would need to see some people to... some more matches to see how this could play out, but at the moment I just feel it's, of course, a very heavy water map, and... yeah, that's it. 90 wood for Russia, that's a nice thing. What else are we gonna have here? Aztec found 40 wood and a small 35 foot treasure. Oh, actually there are just a few cows as well on this map. Looks like Haza is still scouting with his cow, which is always a very nice thing to do, by the way. If you pick up a cow, guys, and you are pretty sure that your opponent can't be anything close to getting it, just make sure that you are using it for some additional scouting around your base, so that your hero can go elsewhere on the map and scout for other further treasures that you can grab before your opponent, or perhaps steal from your opponent.
Yes.
So some friendly chatting there. We also have two islands, by the way, so actually no, so I mean maybe it will come into play like late. But one nice thing is that in this case we start with a saloon, and if we of course it's blocked with by my UI, but there are sometimes nice units in these saloons, which can be a surprise to your opponent, of course. What we see here is Kowenski starting with three villages, which is kind of what you need as Aztecs, I would say. In that way, maybe, yeah, the Russian player has a small advantage shipping the cheaper boat so soon. Then again, he doesn't have wood trickle, of course, but he can go for 700 wood early. Oh, he has 300 gold as starting crates. Oh, and this is also something interesting. Kowenski did make a market, and he probably bought some food with it, which is very smart to do. Bought a house and bought food, I guess, so he aged up very, very fast. As you see here, he's already aged up. And the Russian guy just started. He didn't make a market. What you can do is make a market from the 100 woods, gather the coin, buy a house, and with the rest of the coin you can either do hunting dogs or even buy food to age up faster, or just buy wood or whatever to get your dog out faster. Anyway, getting the crates only takes a little bit of time, but using them in a more useful way is, as the word is saying, probably better. So he is finally gonna... Oh, barely. No, 0 HP. Good job there. So he's gonna get the 90 wood, and then he's gonna start his dog. And the Aztec finds it already. Now this is gonna be interesting, because he just scouted the wood. Does he know about the trick? I believe a trick reflects in the score, although I have to be honest, I don't actually know how much it would affect the score. Anyway, he's going for a forward hut, so it looks like he's not going to go for a heavy sea boom after all. And maybe he's even going to put up the pressure just because he saw this dog from the Russian player. Hold on, I have to be right back for a second, sorry. Okay, looks like using the fact that he aged up so fast, he's still rushing. And of course, knowing that the Russian guy is on ducks. Shipping 700 would first expect it as Russia. He kind of, yeah, he needs to get his blockhouse up probably in the back of his town center, if he can. But it's a nice choice of Kerensky to go for just coyotes and Maesal 10s. Puma not the most effective choice here, because they can still be gunned down by Meadman and town center fire. What he really is looking to do is delay the Russian guy as much as possible. If he can, and that's by the way why the coyotes and Maesal 10s are the best at this point in the game. So if he can delay any blockhouse, of course the Russian guy will have less defense. And if he can delay resources, as he's doing now, a good job with, it means that a sea boom from Russia will be a lot slower. Russia went for 3 ducks, by the way. That is, I think, a little bit too ambitious at this point. I would probably have put down a blockhouse just in case, because it will help so much defending a rush like this. Also, you should always bring your hero back, as I mentioned before. And there we have a nice timing of 5 Cossacks and Meadman, which means that in this case the Meadman and Cossacks should all be targeting coyotes, because those are the biggest damage dealers at this point in the town center as well. And once you clean this up, then the Cossacks and what's left of the Meadman can target down the Maesal 10s. It looks like he's going to get a very favorable trade. Coyotes are somehow in... what was that note? I'm not sure. So he's going to clean up everything. And this one last Cossack should be able to clean up... Well, this is actually... not sure if Kerensky is doing the best thing here. You see it again, the Meadman and the Tower Center all are going to be targeted on the Coyotes. And then it makes me question if it was really worth it. What is the town center now targeting? I hope not. I was targeting a Maesal 10. Of course, the most likely choice for Cossacks again. However, he already used his Meadman, so if the 6 pikemen arrive anytime soon, then he will still have a problem, because he needs his town center to deal with his pikemen first. As you see, there's no blockhouse, possibly a blockhouse going up in the corner. And of course, Kerensky is just going to make coyotes just to make sure that if there's any Cossacks popping, his coyotes plus his massive Maesal 10s will still deal with it. And all he has to do actually at this point is to basically delay the gathering of his opponent, just to make sure that his sea boom can't really flourish that much. In the end, we see it still has quite some boats. If you look at the village account, he's still up 10 villages, because Kerensky is really going for such an aggressive strategy. And he might actually turn in one of those crazy games where he's just gonna sack his town center, rescue his villagers towards his boats, and basically maybe even build a town center somewhere else on the map. Keep in mind that the caravels are still a shipping point, so he can ship, I believe. Not sure if you can actually ship resources, you know. I thought they were a shipping point. Maybe someone in the chat can confirm that. Anyway, these 2 villages will go down. Sad day for them. Oh, one actually will escape. This town center, though, will not. There's a stable going up. No blockhouses so far. And now he's gonna rescue his villagers, or at least some of them. The other one should probably pop out somewhere over here, going to the boats. And actually, the funny thing is, he can just transport them to the island here, as it looks like he might be doing. Although these ones are not. Oh, he's saying again. Boy, that sucks. Yeah, I hope it was that easy. Yeah, I feel that he went a little bit too greedy on water for his Aztec who ages up so fast. With the little coin thing as well. You could, for example, wall a little bit. You could have a blockhouse here before there were two docks. The two caravans were not the most useful idea. You could have even shipped like 5 more Cossacks or so. So there were still options, and the Aztec economy is not the best. So after the Aztecs guy runs out of 10 and 9 maisel tin, you don't really need 34 boats. Look at this, 26 villages. If he had like 29, 30, he would be totally fine as well. So he could have invested, let's say, 4 or 5. That was just another blockhouse, basically, that he could have made instead of these boats. And again, another blockhouse, just instead of a third dock, I believe. Anyway, Kerensky takes it, so 2-0 there. Good job by him. And yeah, a little bit of the post game. You see, all these villagers were constantly. Oh, that's another thing, by the way. If you see something like this is coming, just move some villagers, for example, here. You can even rescue them in a fishing boat, by the way, in case you didn't know that. And some over here. And that means that you never have more than 10 villagers, which is just basically useless in your town center. Or maybe you can go for like 14 or 15 to use them to fight. But basically, you don't want to have all your villagers in your town center because they're just all idle and not doing anything. And they don't really contribute to the additional damage that your town center can do. So spreading out your villagers is always a good option. Even, by the way, just sending them here and gather wood or food or whatever is also an option. You have the boats anyway. So, Kerensky 2-0, advancing to the next round. I will bring the brackets up quickly for you guys, by the way.